At seven, we're in 1978, the year Britain turned disco, and a song that launched a million wannabe John Travoltas onto our dance floors.
When the Bee Gees went and did the music for Saturday Night Fever, they made the one album that made disco. Suddenly, we've got the medallions, the hairy chests, but boy, did we have magnificent songs.
Well, the Bee Gees were machine perfect in what they did. I admire them a lot.
When the brothers would write, melodies and rhythms would come out.
Are we ready to sing?
We never used to say, I wonder if this is a hit, just how many weeks this will be at number one.
Barry was, in those days, a real heartthrob. But then, of course, in your mind, it was also associated with John Travolta. You could picture John Travolta while you were listening to it, and that was an added bonus.
But when Travolta filmed his part in this movie about disco, it still didn't have a soundtrack. Cue a phone call to the Gibb brothers from their manager, Robert Stigwood.
Robert called us in the studio and said, we've got this idea for a movie from a newspaper article called Tribal Rights of a New Saturday Night. That won't be the title of the film, but can you come up with any ideas? And I said, well, yeah, I've got this one called Night Fever. And he said, no, that's too pornographic. And so he just stuck Saturday on the beginning of it, and it made more sense.
Night Fever would be just one of six Bee Gees penned classics to end up on the soundtrack. And it gave the band their third UK number one single.
Night Fever is the perfect dance music for beginners. It's mass movement. Even today, when people want to dance, the first thing I do is put Night Fever on. Three walks forward, a touch and a clap, three walks back, touch and a clap, and suddenly people discover they're dancing. You're on your way.
We're celebrating the chart toppers of the 1970s, a decade of great music and an even greater range of musical styles.
It's such a great decade for a mix of music. You've got your glam rock, you've got heavy rock. Got some cheesy pop.
The 70s was a time when soul music had an orchestra. You're the first, my last, my everything. This was very much a classic sound of the 70s.
The 70s era for me was absolute heaven because I just love that disco sound. The only thing that let it down for me a bit, punk came in. I hated that.
Come on, Tony, where would music and fashion be now if punk hadn't happened, even if it didn't have a number one? Never mind, I think Mr. Blackburn would approve of the all-spinning, all-sparkling song coming up next.
Gloria Gaynor, I Will Survive, has really remained relevant to this very day. At first I was afraid, I was petrified, kept thinking I could never live without you by my side. But then I spent so many nights thinking how you did me wrong, and I grew strong. It is the perfect anthem for a woman scorned. When you're absolutely bereft, you've been destroyed, you're really depressed. I should have changed that stupid lock. I should have made you leave your key. Put that music on and dance your heart out. It's very cathartic.
On the dance floor, you see all the girls going like that to the men and say, I don't need you. Which they don't really, do they? Let's be honest about it. Weren't you the one who tried to hurt me with goodbye?
I can relate so well
to everyone who comes to me and tells me a story about their song. Women tell me that they've been empowered to walk away from difficult marriages. Lots of young people tell me that it encouraged them to get through exams in college. I've had men tell me that it encouraged them to go out one more time and look for that job. The song celebrates the tenacity of the human spirit.
This uplifting message of triumph against the odds even inspired Gloria herself when she was recording the song. But now I hold my head up high
and you can see me, somebody new. When I first stepped up to the microphone to record I Will Survive, I had recently had surgery on my spine. I was still in a back brace, and people were going around the record company saying the Queen is dead, but I survived. So this song was pulling me forward in a way that I hoped that it would do for everyone who listened to it.
It's amazing to think that this disco classic almost slipped through the net.
It was the B-side. And, you know, and I remember finding it on the B-side, not the A-side, which I think was Substitute.
When I heard it, I knew that it should be the A-side. And while the record company refused to even listen to it, I still believed in it, and I took it to Studio 54. The song was played in the clubs, began to be requested in clubs, and then people began to request it from the radio stations. So I would say I Will Survive was a grassroots hit.
We're into the top five now with a chart-topping debut single of a musical maverick.
Kate came out to my flat and she said, I've written this new song. And she started to play ding, 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 ding. It was Wuthering Heights. I said, do you think that's good enough to go on the record? I thought, yes. Out on the wide,
windy moors we roam. Wuthering Heights was a 70s number one like no other. You have a temper like my jealousy, too hard to greet. A song based on a classic novel which soared to the top of the pop charts. When I needed to possess you, I hated you,
I loved you too. When I heard Wuthering Heights, I thought, now this is as strange as it gets for a pop song. I knew the book. And here is this eerie banshee, Kathy the Ghost singing to Heathcliff.
Moved and flailed, and her eyes were dancing. Everything was in the face. Ooh, it gets dark, it gets lonely, on the other side
of you. Kate is an example of an artist following what they really want to do and not caring about trends whatsoever. This is what I do. I like it. I believe in it. And the people buy it.
This is history in the making because it's the first number one in the history of the British chart by a woman, written by that woman. This was the first time, and she was a teenager.
Kate was extraordinary because she had this incredible vocal power, but because she was a trained dancer, she could dance and sing at the same time.
A year after Wuthering Heights topped the charts, Kate reproduced the multitasking performance of her songs on stage in a groundbreaking but seemingly never to be repeated tour.
It is rather an elaborate show that you're doing. Were many people involved in sort of the whole concept, or was it basically all your idea?
Well, the major concept is basically mine. Mm. I've had a lot of help from people, and we've all worked together, really.
I went to see her at the Palladium. I don't think I've seen such an amazing show. The acting, the dancing, the creativity from someone so young.
Ever unpredictable, last year the largely reclusive singer surprised everyone once more.
no doubt in Kate Bush's return is the hottest ticket in town. It's a concert her fans have waited 35 years for.
Yes, after just the 3 decades, Kate Bush was once again singing and dancing live.
You get all the rumours, where's Kate, what's happened to her, blah, blah, blah. And then suddenly, typical her, she comes back and blows everyone away again. Just as sensational as all those years ago.
At number 4, a song that saw a band of former punks cross the great musical divide to dabble in disco. And in the process, become global superstars.
It was an old song that had been around for quite a while, maybe 4 years.
We tried it as a blues, we tried it as a rock song. We tried it as a Latin flavor. And nothing really seemed to fit.
Enter the band's new producer, Mike Chapman, best known at the time for writing and producing hits for Sweet, Susie Quattro, and Mudd.
We were playing him the songs that we had prepared, and then he kept saying, well, do you have anything else? And then we said, well, we've got this old thing, you know.
They played me the song, and I said, it's a bit reggae at the moment, and maybe we should do something different with it. Who do you like out there? She said, Donna Summer, Giorgio Moroder's music. That was the last thing I thought she was going to say. He was the first techno producer. So that's where we started reconstructing the song.
So in New York City in the summer of 78, Chapman and the band got down to creating a perfect slice of electropop very slowly.
These days, just close your eyes and hit a button, it all happens. But in those days, you had to do it. And the whole process had got on everybody's nerves. Nobody was having fun. It was just hard work. But when she stepped up to the mic and that beautiful wispy voice started coming out, suddenly the whole record, there it was.
Debbie's vocal is great. It's very aloof and cool, but also heated.